2022. I'm gonna call it, it was a fantastic year for music. I mean, there were so many great albums, singles, new breakout albums. I'll be honest with you, I think it was a year that like all the huge pop stars, other than like Beyonce, didn't really drop bangers, and it was a lot of like years for like up and coming or like less popular artists that just dropped some of the best albums of the year. So I actually got 33 albums that I'm doing in this ranking. This is mostly what I actually listened to this year, but I also will put disclaimer, these are my albums, not yours, bitch. So this is what I liked. You might not like it. You're probably gonna hate my number one pick, but I love it. And that's what it's about. That's the whole fun point of list. They're kind of arbitrary and don't make any sense. And like, music is super subjective, but like, it's fun to get down at the end of the year, you know, kind of take a look, try and rank some albums, maybe give them a number if you're into that. It's fun. It's just inherently fun. And that's what I did. So let's go ahead and get into it. At number 33, I have Chloe and the Next 20th Century by Father John Misty. I think this album got a little bit too hated on. I will agree, yeah, it is the worst in his discography, but the kind of classical soundscape that Father John Misty goes for on this album, he goes for it and then he just rolls with it. So I think for that, it makes it a very cohesive listen, although some of the tracks do get kind of boring. So at number 32, got Ramona Park, Broke My Heart by Vince Staples. It kind of continues a lot of concepts that were put on his last album, the self-titled, which I loved. I thought like the stuff he was rapping about on it was just fantastic. It gave me a lot of like really Kendrick Lamar vibes, and the way that Kenny Beats did the production on it was just phenomenal. So it kind of brings a lot of the ideas from that last album into this, but albeit in a lot less good of a manner, you know. But there are still some like really great tracks on here, with like With Sparks Fly and Nameless and The Blues, the closer track. There's still some good tracks on here. If you like conscious rap, he's gotten a lot more lyrical with his work in the past, then I would give it a listen. At number 31, I have The Ruby Chord by Richard Dawson. This album is weird, experimental, and folky in this like futuristic dystopian world. It's almost a scary listen at sometimes, but he really nails this experimental folk sound to a degree that I think he hasn't nailed with some of his previous albums. Although it is an album that I can't listen to just like all the time. Like, I don't just throw on the 41 minute track opener, The Hermit. Like, even though it's a great track, it's 41 minutes long. Who has the time to just be like, oh, I'm gonna get in my car, I'm gonna listen to 41 minutes of this super experimental, crazy fucking mindfuck album? Like, no one's gonna do that. But as an artistic statement, this album is great. But because of the length, because it's not as accessible on re-listens, I can't rank it that high as some of these other albums. So at number 30, oh, okay. No one give me shit in the comments. Actually, give me all the shit you want. This is my list though, don't forget that. I have Cheat Codes by Danger Mouse. You know, I really wanted to absolutely love this album, like put it in my top five like some other people have, but for me, it didn't work as well as it did for some other people, which is surprising because Danger Mouse, the one who produced this, along with, you know, of course, the rapper Black Thought, Danger Mouse has produced my favorite MF Doom record, The Mouse and the Mask. So going into this project, I thought I would love it, because I love his production style. If you haven't listened to this album, listen to The Darkest Part, and if you like that, listen to the rest of it. At number 29, I have No Thank You by Little Sims. I'm a little disappointed by Little Sims. She was on an incredible artistic streak with Gray Area and Sometimes I Might Be Introvert, and this album really just feels like Sometimes I Might Be Introvert B-side. You know, with songs like Sideways and Who Even Cares and the last track Control, I found myself getting a little bored. But because Sometimes I Might Be Introvert was such an incredible like artistic vision, there are some great tracks on this album with like Silhouette and Gorilla, because that's just how good of an album Sometimes I Might Be Introvert was. So if you enjoyed her last album, you'll probably enjoy at least one or two tracks off this album. So I would give it a listen. The UK rap scene is in a really good spot, and I think Little Sims is really pushing the envelope as far as that kind of stuff goes. At number 28, I have Wet Leg by Wet Leg. Now, this album got a lot of shit in the music community, and I don't really understand the hate. I think this was a not necessarily innovative indie rock duo to come out of Britain, but a very interesting one. It's really fun and quirky. Like, you can't just not smile when some of their songs play. But I will say, it wasn't incredibly, like, put together as an album, because there were some tracks like Convincing or Your Mom or Supermarket that didn't really do it for me. I thought they were really generic in terms of indie rock, but some of the other tracks, they outshined those duds for me enough for this to be a good listen and something I'd recommend to people who like indie rock. And at number 27, Wasteland by Brent Faiyaz. If you are into R&B and you haven't listened to Brent Faiyaz, what are you doing? His voice is so buttery and silky smooth, and the production on this album is just, it's so like spacey and almost like a Travis Scott rodeo type vibe. So for that, I think it's really great. The thing that sucks though is that it's not really a cohesive listen. There's some duds on here, like serious duds. But some of the amazing tracks on here, like Dead Man Walking, Fuck You to Bed, and Bad Luck, put this in some of my favorite songs of 2022. So at number 26, I have Beatopia by Beebadoobie. Yeah, I know, the artist that, like, what, 3 years ago was on that TikTok song that was like, don't go away for too long, don't go too. That one, yeah, she released a really great album. It's almost like this, it's definitely in the category of, like, indie rock. I think she nails some of, like, the flatline characteristics of indie rock with, like, her very, like, dissonant and, like, light, dense, playful sounds of indie rock. And she puts it in this like very personal style. If you like music, listen to Beatopia by Beebadoobie. All right, Big Tiger, we're getting into the top 25. Can you believe it? I can. So actually at number 25, I have And In the Darkness, Hearts Aglow by Wasteblood. It's this really cool blend of folk rock with like this level of isolation that is just so depressing. This album is so sad. The instrumentals on here are very haunting, and it almost feels like if a ghost and like Joni Mitchell got together, had sex, and had this like haunted baby who was really good at telling stories. If any of that sounds cool, listen to this album. At number 24, I have Gemini Writes by Steve Lacy. This is probably one of my favorite indie rock albums of the year. It's very calculated. I think he's found a sound that suits him well. I'm sure everyone's heard Bad Habit, and that's kind of how the rest of the album is. There are some more experimental ones with like Buttons, and I think that's a great song, but most of it pretty much sticks to that Bad Habit sound palette, and I'm happy it does. It's a sound that works really, really well for Steve. All right, so all of the albums, number 23 and up, are gonna be at least 8 out of 10s in my book. You know, they sounded nice in my ears. I don't know if they sounded nice in his ears, but they sounded nice in my ears, or your ears. But at number 23, I have Few Good Things by Saba. I've been a fan of Saba's work. I thought his last album was incredible. Number 22, I have Blue Rev by Always. The way I would describe this album is it's like that generic indie rock, just with like how you would imagine indie to sound. But then there's like this level of noise that really reminds me of like the soaring guitars of the Pixies. I think there's something here for most fans of indie rock to like. And for that, number 22, that's what it is. And at number 21, I have SOS by none other than the Queen herself. Well, the Queen is later in this list. SZA. I think what she really excels at this album is her hooks and her choruses. I'm a killer. Like, this album is an earworm. It's an earworm where you hear those choruses and you hear those hooks that SZA gives and her just infectious voice, and you just want more, you want more. You're like, oh, give me more, SZA. So yeah, number 21. Top 20, can you believe it? Big Tiger, we're in the top 20. You thought it was crazy when we were in the top 25, didn't you? At number 20, I have Hellfire by Black Midi. These British people, these are some good British people. Hellfire is this like new style of prog rock that just entirely has not been done before. Like, you have not heard anything like this. And look at this guy. This guy's name is Edward Greep. He kind of looks like my friend. I tell him that all the time. But give it up to Black Midi. They dropped a banger of an album. At number 19, I have Melt My Eyes, See Your Future by Denzel Curry. Easily his best album yet. This thing is filled with really great tracks, but it's also filled with some tracks I don't like at all. I mean, like Sandro and X-Wing and Ain't No Way. I'm a big trap hater unless it's like Travis Scott Rodeo. And so anytime I hear those like generic hi-hats, it kind of just turns me off to a song in general. But for the tracks that are really good, like Walkin' and Troubles with T-Pain and Zatoichi with Slow Tie, if you like rap, if you like music, listen to this album. I wish it could be higher, but because of those three tracks I listed, I can't put it that high. At number 18, Boat Songs by MJ Lenderman. I actually saw him here in small town Little Rock. He was playing with his other band Wednesday, and I didn't think much of it at the time, but then this album came out, Pitchfork gave it a really high rating, and I was like, whoa, I need to listen to this. I don't know what to say about this album. Let's see what Pitchfork said. Okay. There you go. That's your opinion on this album. And at number 17, I have Louis by Kenny Beats. Who would have known he would have dropped a solo album? Like, he's a producer. And a lot of times in the music industry, like, producers don't get that much credit. But what he dropped is, like, such a fun album. So, and if you're like me and you need those tracks that have some vocals, at least some of them, then you're really going to love the tracks with like Pink Saifu with Hold My Head and Family Tree with Slow Tie. I like Kenny. I love his work. It's so good and it's so happy. This is such a happy album. Number 16, A Light for Attracting Attention by none other than The Smile. I am a Radiohead stan. They are my favorite band. So of course they're going to have to appear in this list. What this sounds like is it sounds like Radiohead, but they lost like three of their members, so it's not as iconic as some of Radiohead's albums. You might be like, well, it's not all the members, so I don't really want to listen to it, but you'll probably find at least one or two tracks on this album that you like. Tiger, we made it in the top 15. Can you believe it? What? At number 15, I have Detotus Las Flores by Natalia Lafourcade. This album is beautiful, it is intimate, it is jazzy, it is folky, and I don't know what she's saying because I'm a white person. But that does not detract from how great this album is at all. This album got huge praise by critics like Anthony Fantano. I think he put this at his number one. Number one! So props to you, I guess. Moving on, number 14, Queen Bee, Renaissance by Beyonce, number 14. Wow, this is Beyonce's best album. This is my favorite album of hers. I really enjoyed Lemonade. I love the direction she was going with that. But on this album, she essentially like cements herself as one of the greatest like artists of all time and one of the most iconic. This album is so dancey. It doesn't matter if I'm about to like drive headfirst into a deer. I want to just get out of my car or get up and just dance. And at number 13, I have another pop banger of the year that you might have not listened to. It is I Love You, Jennifer B by Jockstrap. Other than like how boring this album cover is, because like, come on, you could have done something cooler, especially with how this album sounds. This album is experimental pop music. It's really like theatrical and the production is just dazzling. And it's lustrous pop music, if that makes any sense at all. British people make good music. At number 12, I have Florist by Florist. Florist is this really, really chill album. Here's what Florist sounds like. They sound like if Phoebe Bridgers and the new Big Thief album had a baby. I know this is like my second comparison of the video, but that's what it sounds like. So if that sounds like a good idea, go ahead and go listen to it. At number 11, Jamie by Montel Fish. So this guy used to make like chill hop trap Christian praise music, but this album isn't really what Montel Fish was before. It is honestly like very Bon Iver. In the same way that Bon Iver's breakout album in 2007 was this like heart-crushing breakup album, that's exactly what this is. Really, it really takes a lot from Bon Iver. I mean, think about the name of it. It's literally Jamie, which is like a past love of his that broke his heart. I like it. Do you like it? We made it into the top 10. Big Tiger, we made it in. Who else to kick off the top 10 but Kendrick Lamar? Number 10, Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers by Kendrick Lamar. He's not necessarily as calculated as he was on like To Pimp a Butterfly, or the beats aren't necessarily as infectious as they were on Good Kid, Mad City. But what we do have is a deep dive into Kendrick's mind. It's really an album about growing as a person and learning from your past mistakes. And it really shows, and it's a solid concept. It's Kendrick, and of course Kendrick is gonna appear in a top 10. He is Kendrick fucking Lamar. What do you think, Big Tiger? Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers is, it's not a masterpiece, but it's really good. It's really good. At number 9, I have Cave World by Viagra Boys. The way I would describe this album, it is a feral take on post-punk. Imagine if the Talking Heads and Slint had a baby. I know, another baby one. But Talking Heads and Slint had a baby, and they're also from Sweden. That is what this album by Viagra Boys is. They are just out of this world with how these songs progress, with how just absolutely monkey. Like, they are gorillas on this album. Like, number 8, Labyrinthus by Destroyer. I didn't know Destroyer could be good again. Not necessarily that they were bad, but like Caput is a modern classic. If you know Destroyer, you know that that album is incredible. The way I would describe Labyrinthus is it kind of has some of the sonic values of Caput, and that kind of like jazzy with all the horns and the really like dreamy pop kind of guitars. It takes a lot of that, but it does it in its own way, and I like it for that. And at number 7, I have God Save the Animals by Alex G. This album is beautiful. I mean, it is just track after track of really, really solid tunes in the like experimental folk kind of genre. Prog folk, art folk, whatever you want to call it. But sometimes it gets really, really simple. You know, with Running, you know, my running, like, it's very infectious, just in the same way that like Beyonce is with some of her hooks. That makes no sense. What are you fucking talking about? We gotta move on. Number 6, I have You Can't Kill Me by 070 Shake. This is like the last good artist on the Kanye West Good Music label, and I hope that 070 Shake can get off it after what Kanye has proved himself to be a dick. But because she's on that label, she has access to the legendary producer Mike Dean, and his influence definitely shows on this album. But this album is industrial. It's like if Yeezus had a female artist, that like Kanye was like a female and Yeezus was made. At number 5, this has to be in the number 5. You're probably like, oh, where's you gonna put it? The Forever Story by J.I.D. Now, are you pissed that it's not number 1? Probably. If you are, it's my list. It is just banger after banger after banger after banger with features that are incredible. Like, I mean, the only song I don't like on this album is Just In Time, and I still really, really like it. I mean, this album is like almost a 10, and I think the next album he drops is probably going to be a 10. This is like, I hate to always use these comparisons because it's like being like, oh, well, this album is this and this next album is going to be like this because this artist did this. This album is like Section 80, and the next album he's going to drop is going to be Good Kid, Mad City, and the next album he's going to drop is going to be the perfect To Pimp a Butterfly. Like, he's just going to get better and better and better. And that's what he's been doing, and he's going to keep doing it. This album is like a cultural statement, and it's some of the coolest rap that I've heard this year. Not the coolest, though, you'll see. Number 4. Dragon New Warm Mountain, I Believe in You by Big Thief. You know, the worst part about this album is that long-ass name. But it is just track after track of banger. Of folk indie alternative banger. The lead singer on this album, Adrienne Lenker, is like a generational talent. She is a beautiful storyteller. She fits the instrumentals of this album so well. I can't wait to see what Big Thief does next. I don't know what else to say other than what's my number three pick. And that would be Love for Rent by Shmino. You gotta make sure you say Shmino. It's not Smino, it's Shmino. It is just track after track of like jazzy and like weird and funky. It's very funky. This album is so fun, but it also has some of its sad moments with songs like Mode in a Minute. Honestly, what this album reminds me, like, this is what, if you've ever seen Norbit, you know these guys, the pimps. This is what they would listen to. That's the sound palette of Love for Rent by Shmino. There's just so many sick drum breaks on this album, sick like guitar progressions, and this is supposed to be a rap album, but it's literally what these guys would listen to. And I love these guys. They're like the funniest part of that movie. But Shmino, man. Shmino. At number two, I have Ants From Up There by Black Country New Road. This is going to be one of the best albums of the decade. It's going to make my top 10 list in the decade. I can't believe two albums from this year are going to make like a top 10 list of the decade. And unless there's just something else that surpasses it, or like they get Isaac Wood back. Wow. This is one of the greatest prog art rock albums I have ever heard. I really, really loved their first album with For the First Time. I thought it was more than just a Slint tribute act, like some people were saying. I enjoyed the post-punk direction they were on, but they just took it a whole nother direction. And now it's like, most people are probably going to be more open to this than some people, because you got to like post-punk to like their last album. But if you're just a fan of music, you'll probably like this album. It's very rare that I've talked to someone who hasn't enjoyed this album. British people make the best music. And that's why Black Country New Road is my second favorite album of the year. This album has this is going to be the best scream of the decade. This one right here. And so my number one pick of... You can drop all the hate comments and you want if you want for this, because most people are probably gonna fucking laugh at this. But at number one, this is my list. I Didn't Mean to Haunt You by Quadeca. Whoa, I did not think he could make an album like this. It's a concept album about him killing himself and becoming a ghost, and that kind of sounds corny on first thing. But once you get into the lyrics and you kind of read the genius meanings, or really let yourself get absorbed into his sonic world. He does the concept justice in the same way that like The Wall nails its concept. I hate to compare those albums, but like this is a legendary album for me. Most people probably won't agree with me, and you might laugh at me because apparently he's a YouTube rapper, but he's no longer a YouTube rapper. He's an artist, and Quadeca made my favorite album of the year. And you know, it really depends on the kind of day I'm having, which album I think is better, if it's the Black Country New Road album or if it's the Quadeca album. But you know, sometimes I ask myself, at the end of the day, what the fuck do these year-end lists even matter for? Like, music is subjective. It just is, you know? And what I put, or what you put, or what this melon puts, or what this tiger likes in terms of music, it really doesn't matter. This is what I liked, and I hope maybe you saw some and you liked the description I gave it and you went and listened to it and maybe you enjoyed it. And if you did, awesome. Then it looks like this video helped you in some way, because music is a beautiful thing. It's something I'm really passionate about. Let me know what you thought of the list down in the comments. If you loved it, if you hate it, if you want to like do hate speech, you can do hate speech in the comments and like tell me I'm dumb for liking Quadeca or something. But yeah, 2022, year-end list. Woohoo!